is seated and he ain't worried about it because he rules over it. Amen? Amen. Well, you guys may be seated. Again, it is good to see everyone here this morning. I told you earlier, I'm not going to preach, but I do have some encouragement for you. And then I can't wait to just hang out later today with family because I do consider all of you family. Well, I am someone who believes that God still speaks today. I believe that he speaks, of course, through his word. He speaks through people as they bring us wisdom or encouragement. He speaks through creation. But for me, I really experience God speaking the most, and I hear him the best through experiences. And I had an experience this past week with my family, and specifically my youngest son, Jude, that I can't wait to share with you because, man, God wrecked me in this experience and through this story. And I really think that everyone in the room can get something out of it, even of our kids, because I'm going to have Jude come up here and join me to tell this story. Can you give it up for Jude real quick? Come on, buddy. Come on up here. He actually didn't know he was going to do this till right before worship, but he's going to help me share this story with you. So I was with the pastoral team the first few days of the week. We were down at the lake and having a great time. We had a great time, right?
Yeah.
All right. So we were hanging out on the dock, and we were all just tired from swimming. We went out boating, and we were literally just hanging on the edge of the dock with our feet in the water. So why don't we just mimic that right here? Go ahead and have a seat right here. Right here. Have a seat. So we were just hanging out on the dock, feet in the water, chilling, talking, catching up. And then what started to happen around our feet?
Fish nibbled on them.
These bluegills started coming up and nibbling on our feet. And I thought for sure the ladies and the kids would freak out, but they were loving it. Matter of fact, Mikey was even letting these, like, bluegill run all over her feet. And I'm like, there ain't no way. Like, I can't believe what I'm seeing right now. But she was loving it. Kids were loving it. And then after about 5 or 10 minutes, just letting the fish nibble, there was probably how many fish, you think?
20.
I was going to say 12. 20 is probably better. There was like 20 full-grown bluegill just swimming around, nibbling at our feet. And then Jude here decides that he's going to catch one. And so he actually started putting his hands in right when they would come to the top and try to grab them with his hands. Well, of course, the fish were so fast, that really didn't work. So you had a little bit of bait. You remember what you used first?
Goldfish.
No, the first.
Oh, wait, bucket. A bucket.
No.
Oh, I did use crushed up Doritos.
Yeah, he did. So he's like, we got a bag of Doritos here. So he started crushing them up, sprinkling on the top. And of course, fish are going crazy. He's trying to grab them, can't get it. So then when that didn't work, he was determined to catch a fish, weren't you? So he started looking around and he's like, what can I use to catch this fish? So he finds this like bin on the dock. He opens it up. And wouldn't you know it, in there is this small bucket. Why don't you go get that bucket from Mom real quick? There's already fish in it. Well, we'll leave that for later. Hold on. So he grabs this bucket, and this isn't the exact bucket, but it's about this size. And he's like, I'm going to catch a fish. Well, I see him grab this bucket, and I'm like, Jude, put that back. It's not our bin. It's not our bucket. And you cannot catch a fish with a bucket. He goes, do you remember what you said?
Bet.
He said, bet. It's exactly what he said. And I said, okay, we'll actually bet with this. So if you catch a fish with this bucket, I'm going to buy you candy every day for the next 30 days. A month of candy. I said, but if you don't catch one with this bucket, then I will not buy you candy. You will get no candy for the next 30 days, period. Did you take the bet?
No.
He's like, he thought about it. He didn't just answer right away, no. He's like, man, I want to catch this fish. I know I'm going to catch one, but no. He like, I saw him. He was wrestling within himself, fighting within himself. And then he said, No, I'm not going to take that bet. But at least I'm going to try. And I'm like, okay. So he grabs the bucket and he's down here and he's like this. Tries twice, sprinkles some Doritos, can't do it. So then Titus, my other son's like, we got some goldfish. Somehow in his mind, catching fish with goldfish made sense. So he sprinkles some goldfish in this bucket. The very first time a fish swims by, pulls it up, and I kid you not, Jude, dang it, he catches a fish in this bucket. Matter of fact, I brought proof. Matter of fact, I got a picture. Let's see that picture. Let's see it. So he catches a fish, and I'm like, oh, my gosh. Matter of fact, if there was video with this, I'd be like, no, he didn't. No. Oh, my God, no, he did not just catch a fish. I was freaking out because I could not believe that this could actually happen. And if you see it, it is literally this size, and he catches a full-grown bluegill in this bucket. And so I told him, I'm like, well, I'll tell you what, you didn't take the bet, but how about I buy you one thing of candy? And then so I got him some Swedish fish for catching it. But then I'm thinking, you know what? I made that original bet, and I'm the one who put doubt and confusion in him. I'm the one who put consequences on him and, like, overpowered his mindset with, well, I want to really do it. I think I can do it. I believe I can do it. But if that's going to be the consequence of me not doing it, no, I'm not going to take that bet. So Jude and I worked out a deal. Not only does he get goldfish, we have, like, 40 or 50 boxes of Swedish fish and candy, and Jude wanted to share his month's supply of candy with all of the kids here today. So, kids, you can thank Jude for catching the fish. There you go. And he'll be in the lobby with those bags of candy after the service. And if it's okay with your mom and dad, you can have one. All right, thanks, Jude. Give it up for Jude real quick. Jude is the man. So, why did I share that story? Why did I take so long doing that? Well, I'm only going to share just a few things, but I think this is so powerful because isn't it just like kids that challenge us as adults in our faith? Isn't it just like kids that push us beyond what we think is possible? Isn't it like a kid to teach us how to put full trust and faith in something, to actually try and step out? Because many of us as adults, we've tried and failed. We've stepped out and it didn't work. We've tried so many times and maybe something didn't work out that we're not willing to try anymore. But that moment Jude was like, well, I'm not going to take that bet, but at least I'm going to try. That has been wrecking me all week long. Because isn't it like a kid to teach us how to have faith? And as I was thinking about that story this week, I couldn't help but think about what Paul was writing to the church in Corinth. In Corinth, these are new believers. These are baby Christians, if you will. These were people just still trying to figure out how to follow Jesus. And he actually writes this. I do have some scripture for all of us today. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, right up front, verses 26 through 31. Real quick, let's check this out. He says this, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many of you were influential. Not many of you were noble birth. But, verse 27, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. He's talking about the cross. How the cross is foolishness. How could a God come and actually give up his life and die on the cross for humanity? And this thought process doesn't make sense to us that Jesus did everything for us and we have to do nothing. But it takes childlike faith in what Jesus did to actually activate that in our life so that we can walk confidently with peace in our life today. And then he goes on to say this, and I've never caught this before this week, verse 30, and I want everyone in the room to catch this. It is because of him. Let me stop. Let me repeat that. It is because of him. Help me out, everybody. Because of who? Him. It's because of him that you are in Christ. See, for so many years, for so long, we've taught that we have to do stuff, that we got to say prayers, we got to show up at the altar, we got to give a certain percentage, we got to do all these things to prove that we are in Christ, but none of that stuff matters. It is because of Him that we are in Christ. It is a finished, completed work, and He says it's because of Him who has become for us wisdom from God. It's the mind of Christ, right? That is our righteousness, right standing, our holiness, our redemption. Verse 31, therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. You know, there's a lot of things that I've tried to boast in. Look what I've done. Look what I can do. Matter of fact, I'm in this point right now in season of my life where I haven't really stepped out and tried new things because I've been there, done that. They haven't worked. But man, what Jude's been teaching me is, as I have faith, I can continue to step out, realizing no matter the consequence, God's going to be with me. No matter the consequence, I'm going to be blessed. Just like, Abraham told his nephew Lot, you go this way, I'm going to go. If you go right, I'm going to go left. If you go left, I'm going to go right. Because he realized that it was him that was blessed, not the decision. And so realize that you're blessed at all times, that you're loved at all times, that you're accepted at all times. And what I love about this thought process, thinking about it and putting our trust in Jesus and his finished work and what he did, that it's because of him we're in Christ. I also couldn't help but go to Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. I told you I'm going to be quick, so I got two more things. Paul actually also writes this, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourself. It is the gift of God, right? It's through faith, but faith in what? Not in what we do and what he has done. Not by works, so that no one can boast. And then verse 10, I've never seen this before either. For we are God's handiwork created in Christ Jesus. Again, it's because of him we're in Christ. And here it says we are created in Christ. So why is the church from centuries past have been telling people that they were created in Adam, not in Christ? That they were created as lowly, worthless, bad, rotten sinners, not as loved and fully accepted sons and daughters of God. That they are beautiful, that they are made whole, they are made perfect. They're fully accepted sons and daughters of God. Why? Because they were created in Christ. And we were created in Christ to do good works, which he prepared in advance for us to do. And so it's faith, not in ourself, it's faith in Jesus and his finished work. And that is childlike faith. That is stepping out, saying, I'm going to continue to put my trust in him. Yeah, there's a lot of things that might come at us that might not make sense. There's things that come at us that we are going to have to wrestle with. But at the end of the day, I trust, like Brittany said earlier, that his promises are yes and amen. That we are perfected, whole, loved, and he will never leave us nor forsake us. So then what really counts in faith and in our life? And I'm going to close and I'm going to end it with this. And then we got stuff to do out in the lobby. Paul also writes to the Galatian church. He says this, speaking of this theme in Christ. For in Christ, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. And I'm not going to touch on that. We got a lot of kids in the room. Let me just bypass that. But basically what he's saying is not what we do, what we don't do. Right? It's not our works, anything like that. And then he actually says this exact thing. The only thing that counts. How many of us, man, we go around, we want our life to count. We want our life to matter. We want to know we're making a difference. I know for me, like, that's what I think about at all times. I just want my life to matter. I want my life to count. Well, here is how our life counts. Paul specifically tells us right here in this verse. The only thing that counts, because we're already in Christ. People you meet, they're in Christ. Paul, in other places, in Acts 17 says, for we in him we live, move, have our being, for we are all God's children. Right? We're all in Christ because it's his doing, not ours. So in Christ, then the only thing that counts, it's not a free-for-all, live however you want kind of life. If you want a life that counts, it's faith, faith in Jesus, right? In him and his finished work, what he's done on our behalf. The only thing that counts is that kind of faith expressing itself through love. Because we can't say we love God and not love the people that are around us, period. And that is having that childlike faith. And I know even my boys and the children we see, they don't meet strangers. That stuff is taught in them. It's caught in them. I'll say it like this. When you understand how much you're loved and you understand how much grace you've been shown, there's a level of grace then that we are to show to other people. And we don't measure the level of grace that we have by how we love Jesus. We measure the grace by how we love the Judas in our family. You know, it is 4th of July week. We're going to be around family. We're going to be around people, maybe at parties and gatherings and things like that. What if this year you were the person that showed the most love to every person that's there? What if you were the one that was actually dictating how people felt around you, that they felt loved and accepted and valued instead of being put down or called out? What if you were the ones that actually built up and encouraged? And I know I've been a little bit all over the place with this, but I really want you to walk out of this place actually with an understanding that Jesus did it all because of him. You are in Christ. I want you to have assurance of that. It's nothing you can do. You are in Christ. But what really counts now in our life is that faith expressing itself in love. It is the command that we're under in the new covenant. We loved as Christ loved us. That's fully, unconditionally. And that's how we are to love others. So this 4th of July weekend, can we do that? Amen. Well, let me pray for you, and I'm going to give you some direction on the rest of the day. Amen. Father, thank you so much, as always, for the opportunity that we have to come and gather as sons and daughters. I just pray right now that people that are here, they would maybe today get an understanding that they are in you, that they've never been out of you. Their behavior didn't get them in Christ, so their behavior can't get them out of Christ. That they are fully in you, accepted, loved, and valued. And I pray that it's our job now to express our faith in love, to awaken people to the love of an amazing Father, to awaken people of the work that was done on their behalf. And as they are awakened to that, the kingdom begins to explode in their life of righteousness, peace, and joy. And that is my prayer for every single person, to live out that kind of life, the full, abundant life that you came to bring. And it's in your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, church, man, I am so encouraged by you coming out today and joining us on this holiday weekend. As I said earlier, this was going to be a little bit of a different day because we did want to take a little time for people to connect, for people to really deepen relationship. And we also wanted to create something that would just be a little bit of fun for families. And so in the lobby, Pastor Tish has 7 different stations set up. Some of them are fun little games. Some of them are games with prizes. Some of them are just silly games. Some of them are just places you can get something to drink or a snack, things like that. And I hope that you just stay. We purposefully ended. I wanted to be done by 11:15. It is 11:15 on the dot. So, man, I'm actually so proud of myself right now for that. Not preaching for like a half an hour. So for at least the next 15 to 20 minutes, I'm going to encourage you. Would you guys hang out? Would you guys hang out, connect with other families? Have a conversation with someone that you normally don't have time for because we're running after church to dinners, to parties, to lunches, or whatever else. So we purposely ended today to give you time to connect with the family here at Hill City. And I hope that you take us up on that. And with that, as we walk out towards the lobby and as we end and conclude the service, I do want you to know that you are loved and there's nothing that you can do about it. We'll see you next Sunday, but I'm going to see you out in the lobby. Bless you, church.